It's evident from the Bible that in time past, the only way a Gentile could be blessed of God was if they blessed the nation of Israel. An illustration of that would be Acts chapter 10. In Acts chapter 10, there's a man who was a devout man. He prayed to God always. He feared God and gave much alms to the Jewish people. In other words, he blessed the nation of Israel. And with one accord with God's promise to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, God blessed Cornelius. God had said to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verse 3, he said, I'll bless them that bless you and curse them that curse you. So God sent his angel to Cornelius and told him what to do. Send for Peter. So in time past, Genesis through chapter 10 of Acts and the account of Cornelius, the Roman centurion, the only way a Gentile could get to God was through the nation of Israel. If a Gentile blessed the seed of Abraham, God blessed that Gentile. Another example would be the Syrophoenician woman in Matthew chapter 15, who likened herself to the position of a dog under the table, eating the crumbs of the children's bread. When she acknowledged Jesus as Lord, and when she placed herself in the position of a dog under the table, then, and only then, did the Lord grant a request. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, crumbs fell from the table to a few Gentiles. And Jesus said in Matthew chapter 15, verse 24, I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And Romans 15 and 8 says, now I say, Paul says, that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God, confirming the promises made to the fathers. In his earthly ministry, the Lord came unto his own, according to John 1:11, and the ministry recorded in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John was to Israel and Israel alone. But in Romans 11, we find that Israel has fallen. We find that through the fall of Israel, salvation has come to the Gentiles apart from the nation of Israel. Israel has fallen, they've been diminished, and they have been cast out among the Gentiles, cast away. God said in the book of Hosea, chapter 1, verse 9, for you are not my people, and I will not be your God. A prophecy of the very time in which we now live. So the nation of Israel today is scattered among the nations. And so the position of the Gentiles today is on equal terms with Israel. Neither are good. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the salvation for Israel today is the same as it is for any person on earth. It's through the ministry of the church, which is the body of Christ. The position of Israelites and the Gentiles is the same. Both have been accursed from God, but God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. The point being that today, but now, as Paul calls it, God has provided the means whereby anybody, no matter who they are, black, white, yellow, no matter their moral condition, no matter their past situation, no matter who they are, where they are, or where they've been, no matter the case, God has fixed it so that all can be saved. All can come to the Lord through what Jesus Christ did. In the age in which we live, there is no blessing or no special position of any one person or group above another. But in the future, at a point in time, God will laugh at the nations. He'll have them in derision. In the future, the wrath of God will be poured out on an unbelieving world. The day of vengeance of our God will come, and people will turn by the thousands to the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist, believing that he's the Christ, the son of the living God. So then, in the past, during the time period of the book of Acts, there had to be two groups of people, two bodies of believers, not two bodies of Christ. There's only one church, the body of Christ, but two groups of believers. There was the church, which is the body of Christ, which had begun to be formed at that time through the gospel, which was committed to the Apostle Paul. But then there was a nation of Israel, the new nation of Israel, the Israel of God, being formed through the ministry of the apostles, through Peter, James, and John, and so forth. Now, this is very clear when you consider Galatians chapter 6 and verse 16. In Galatians 6:16, you find a group of people following this rule, Paul's rule, and another group Paul refers to as the Israel of God. Read the verse, Galatians 6:16. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them, and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. After the cross, there's a holy priesthood being formed. The apostles are the founding fathers of that Israel of God, which is also a priesthood. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1 says that Jesus Christ is the apostle and high priest of our profession. The profession of those Hebrews was that of a priesthood. Peter later writes to them. And look at what he says in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9. Peter says, "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." The church of Matthew 16, "Upon this rock I'll build my church," is the new nation of Israel. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 21, verse 43, he said, "Therefore say I unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof." The church of Matthew 16, the church which was at Jerusalem, the water-baptized Pentecostal church of Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 3 and so on, is a church, it is a royal priesthood, and it's also a holy nation, the new nation of Israel, the Israel of God. You'll notice, if you read carefully the book of Acts, that it's that assembly that begins to fade away as time goes by, and after the time of Acts chapter 15, it's no longer in the pages of the book, and the attention has been turned totally to the ministry of Paul. Paul, the apostle of the Gentiles, and according to his own words in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 16, the first and also the pattern of something entirely new and separate from the Israel of God. The church, the body of Christ, began with the salvation of the Apostle Paul, and the body of Christ begins to grow as the other fades out of the picture. As in doctrine, the doctrine and the ministry of the Apostle Paul grows in the first century, while the doctrine and the ministry committed to Peter and the 12 fades away and diminishes out of the picture. So I know that there were two groups of believers there in the time period of the book of Acts. Your religious leader may not know this, but the way I know, and the way you can know, that there had to be two groups of people there is because the doctrine in the books which were written at that time did not say the same things. They contradict each other, and God is not the author of confusion. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10, Paul says that you all speak the same thing, that there be no division among you. How can all believers be in the same group and defend the doctrine of the books of Hebrews, James, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, Jude, and Revelation, while at the same time believing the doctrine of Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Colossians, and Thessalonians? How can that be? How can you possibly have an assembly, a group of Bible believers, anywhere in the world today, where part of that group witnesses on the basis of the Hebrew epistles, as in Hebrews through Revelation, while the other part witnesses on the basis of Paul's epistles, of Romans through Philemon, and all of them speak the same thing. It cannot be done. You know, if you read the Bible, that it's impossible. Something has to be compromised, and religion might as well face it. If you're involved in the denominational religious system today, you're in a situation where you compromise these things. You have been taught to believe that really they're saying the same thing. They just had a different style of writing, or you have to look at it in a different light. Well, they are not saying the same things. A person who says that, I believe the Bible means what it says, where it says it, as it says it, can't possibly say it all says the same thing. How could you possibly say, for instance, that what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 19, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal, how could you possibly say that that's the same thing that Paul said when he said the fathers should lay up for their children? How is be like the birds? They don't toil, they don't work, and God feeds them. How much better are you? In Luke chapter 12, verses 22 through 24, how is be like the lilies? God clothes them. Now, the illustration is that God knows what you need to eat and drink and wear, and God will provide it. While on the other hand, Paul said to the Thessalonians, if any man won't work, neither should he eat. 2 Thessalonians 3 and 10. And in the book of Acts chapter 2, Peter says, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins. And in Acts chapter 3, verse 19, he gives the interpretation of that passage when he says that your sins may be blotted out at the times of refreshing when God sends Jesus Christ. In other words, Peter is telling them to repent and be baptized, looking unto remission of sins at the second coming of Christ. The Bible says the deliverer will roar out of Zion, Romans 11:27. In other words, the day of atonement for the nation of Israel is the second coming. And yet, when Paul writes the Roman letter, Paul says, Romans 5:11, and not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. How can we look for the atonement at the second coming when we've already received it? How can we endure to the end in order to be saved at the end when we've already been saved by grace through faith, Ephesians 2 and 8, sealed with the Holy Spirit, Ephesians 4 and 30, and placed into the body of Christ, 1 Corinthians 12:13. Paul says that we're saved by grace through faith in what Jesus Christ did for us. But Peter writes in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13, wherefore gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 3, verses 6 and 14 says that in order to be a partaker of Christ, that the individual must endure unto the end. And yet I read in 1 Corinthians that we who are saved by grace through faith are already in the body of Christ. And according to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 6, that we are partakers of His promise in Christ, the promise of eternal life, by the gospel. Now, how can you already be in the body of Christ, already a partaker of Christ, and already a partaker of the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, and the salvation of Christ, and the atonement of Christ, and at the same time look forward to all of that at the second coming of Christ? Do you know what this says? This says to me that there are some people in the world today, in the religious system of the world, that either can't read sixth grade English, or else they don't care what the Bible says anyway, as long as they have a look-good, feel-good religion and whatever gimmicks necessary to build assemblies and organizations. God doesn't have any instructions in the Bible about building assemblies and organizations. He says, preach the word. Be instant in season or out of season. Reprove and rebuke with all longsuffering and doctrine. Now, if God called people to start churches, where does the Bible say that? He said, preach the word. He said they'll not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust, they'll heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they'll turn away from the truth. What you've been hearing here is truth. If you read your Bible, and if you really believe that the books of Hebrews through Revelation means exactly what they say, and you believe that Romans through Philemon means exactly what they say, then you can't possibly believe that they're saying the same things to the same person. So, there are two groups of people involved. In Acts chapter 2, there were 3,000 people added to that assembly. In Acts chapter 4, there were 5,000 added. And in Acts chapter 21, James tells Paul, there are many thousands of Jews that believe, and they are all zealous of the law. Yet my Bible tells me that a man who's zealous for the law, as in Galatians chapter 5, verse 4, is fallen from grace. Now, how can we be in the grace of God by faith in Jesus Christ and be zealous of keeping the law at the same time when, if we're zealous of the law and keep the law, we're fallen from grace? How can you be in God's grace and fallen from it at the same time? It's impossible. So then, they of the church at Jerusalem surely were not in the grace of God, as in salvation by grace through faith without any works at all. They were working for the grace which was to be revealed to them at the end. Whereas Paul says in Titus chapter 3, verse 5, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us. Yes, there were Gentiles saved in Peter's program, if you please, but Peter's program faded away and God turned to Paul's program, fearing God and working righteousness in order to be accepted, as Peter told Cornelius in Acts chapter 10, verse 35, is not the same as what Paul wrote to Titus, salvation without any works at all. You can't possibly say that both of them believed the same thing and that both of them were in the same body of believers, while you believe at the same time that God's not the author of confusion. If God Almighty told two different people in the same group two different doctrines, then he's bringing confusion amongst his own, and that cannot happen. Read in 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5. Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. So, in the Pentecostal church, in the book of Acts, the Lord was forming a priesthood. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 6. Wherefore also it's contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Verse 7, unto you therefore, the people to whom Peter wrote the letter, which believe, that is, believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, unto you therefore which believe, he's precious. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they are appointed. And now verse 9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who's called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Obviously, somebody Peter's writing to, somebody who's alive when Peter wrote the passage, go to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6. Wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you're in heaviness through manifold temptations. And verse 7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. And verse 8, whom having not seen, you love, in whom though now you see him not, yet believing, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Now watch this next verse, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 9, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your soul. But you can't find a single verse of Scripture in Romans through Philemon that tells you that the end of your faith is the salvation of your souls, as in enduring unto the end to be saved. I challenge you to find one. There is no such verse of Scripture there. In fact, Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13, that if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. You see, according to Galatians chapter 2, verse 16, we are justified by the faith of Christ. It's his faith that endured unto the end in our behalf. Romans chapter 3, verse 22, we are righteous by the faith of Christ. His faith endured. And on and on and on in Romans through Philemon. The doctrine in the passages of the Scriptures in Hebrews through Revelation is not the same as in Romans through Philemon. Go back to 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. A chosen generation, a royal priesthood. There's no such reference in Romans through Philemon. Not one single indication that you're a priesthood in the body of Christ. There's no such thing in Romans through Philemon as the priesthood of the believer. It's just not there. Never does Paul refer to you or himself as a priest in any way, shape, form, or fashion. But Peter says in 1 Peter 2 and 9, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation. Do you realize that in Christ there's no such thing as nationality? In Christ there's neither male nor female, bond nor free, Jew nor Greek. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15. And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him who died for them and rose again. Wherefore, henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, he was a Jew. The flesh goes back through David to Abraham as a physical human being. Yet henceforth know we him no more. And verse 17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And yet, in 1 Peter 2 and 9, Peter is talking about a chosen generation, a holy nation. The people referred to in 1 Peter chapter 2 are the priesthood of the Lord. Jesus Christ is an high priest, according to Hebrews chapter 3, verse 1, and as such, must have a priesthood. And that priesthood is made up of Israelites. They're all Israelites, or else are associated with and joined to Israel as Israelites. Notice what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. For as the body, that's the human physical body, is one, and hath many members, like arms, legs, fingers, or toes, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ, watch it, for by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. And in verse 18, but now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body, as it hath pleased him. Go to verse 27. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. Look in Galatians chapter 3. Galatians 3, verse 26. For you are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Verse 27. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Now, you know that could not be water baptism if you believe the next verse. Peter wrote to a holy nation, a holy priesthood, a people of God who were baptized with the baptism of repentance. He said in Acts chapter 2, repent and be baptized. And they were water baptized and added to the church. And the church is a physical church. And that physical church at Jerusalem sold everything they had in Acts chapter 2 and Acts chapter 4 and laid it at the apostles' feet, and distribution was made to every man as he had need. Physical human beings. And those physical human beings must endure unto the end, to the Day of Atonement, to be saved. Go with me to Leviticus chapter 16 and verse 30. For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that you may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. And then look at Peter in Acts chapter 3, verse 20. And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you. And look at Paul in Romans chapter 11, verse 27. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sin. The believers of the Pentecostal church were physically baptized with water, physically identified with their Messiah in a fleshly manner by being baptized with water. But you know as well as I know that the water never changed one single thing about their physical being any more than water baptism changes yours. Now back in Galatians chapter 3, Galatians 3 and 26. For you are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. It has to be a spiritual baptism, as in 1 Corinthians. Watch verse 28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Christ Jesus. It's absolutely impossible to make that church of Acts 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and so on fit this description. That church is very physical. In their physical existence, they must have food, they must have clothing, and they are to look to God for what they'll eat, what they'll drink, and what they'll wear. But God told you, get a job. God said for you to get a job and go to work so that you could provide for your family to give them to them that need. And yet, those people in the church of Jerusalem believed Christ in Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, verse 22, and he said unto his disciples, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, neither for your body, what you shall put on. And verse 29, and seek not what you shall eat, or what you shall drink, neither be ye of doubtful mind. And verse 31, but rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. And verse 32, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. But the only way they could get into the kingdom was by resurrection. They would have to die. Love not their lives unto death, and be raised from the dead to get into the kingdom. But in our case, Paul said, behold, I show you a mystery. There is no rapture for those in 1 Peter, 2 Peter, the book of Hebrews, James, and so forth. There's no rapture for them without them dying. But there is that possibility for you. Now, it all comes down to this. Jesus Christ is our Lord and our Savior. Jesus Christ himself bore our sins on the cross. Jesus Christ not only redeemed us, but Jesus Christ atoned us by his finished work. For those of us who believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, the body of the sins of our flesh has been placed upon him, and Jesus Christ died for our sins, paid for our sins. They were taken away, paid for by his death. the wages of sin is death. Christ died. And now, salvation is complete for those that believe. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. And so today, the good news, the greatest news on the face of the earth, is that there's not a single person on earth who has to do anything to gain favor with God. Jesus Christ gained favor for you. Jesus Christ found grace in the eyes of the Lord for you. He fixed it so that God could be gracious to you. Jesus Christ died for all men without exception. He died for all men without distinction. So it makes no difference who you are, where you've been, or what you were doing while you were there. Provision for your salvation is clear in the Bible, and God will favor you. In fact, He does favor you and show favor to you today. God's not judging the world today. He's not judging you today. By the shed blood of Jesus Christ, God's throne has been made into a throne of mercy and of grace in this dispensation of the grace of God in which we live. God's not going around with a club just waiting for you to trip up. God's not getting even with people, making people sick, putting them in the hospital, causing financial curses, or any such thing. God is not judging people, any people, in the age in which we live. You can't do good or do good works in order to gain favor with God. In fact, unless you're already saved by the grace of God, there's nothing you can do that's any good anyway. The Bible says your righteousnesses are as filthy rags. The Bible said there are none that are good. If you're not saved by the grace of God, then you're not good. You can't be good. You can't do good. According to my Bible, all the things you can do that you might think of as good deeds in the eyes of God, they're just like filthy rags. They're of no value whatsoever. There is none righteous. We live in the age today where the issue pertaining to your salvation is not the question of whether you're good or bad, since God says that's out of the question anyway, since you're bad and no good. It's not the question of whether you do good, since God says you don't do good. There are none that doeth good. It's not a question whether some preacher or priest has declared you righteous, or whether you claim to have sought God at an old-fashioned altar. The Bible says there are none that seeketh after God. They've gone all astray. The Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So, if you're not saved by the grace of God, your condition in the world today is that you're lost. But there's hope for you. There's hope for you in view of the fact that Jesus Christ died for you at Calvary. And by His death on the cross, God can show favor to you right now. If you'll trust His Son as your Savior, and if you'll claim Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then God Almighty will save you. If you'll receive Jesus Christ, believing that He died for your sins, was buried, and that God raised Him from the dead, believing that He paid for all your sins, then God will receive you. You don't have to go anywhere, do anything, or say anything in order to be saved right now. But you must believe. You must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as your only Savior. If you haven't done it, will you do it today? Trust in the Lord with all of your heart.